picture. We talked about a couple of them. One certainly was the test of menial tasks. We talked about the test of the mundane, right? Everybody remember that? And did we finish with the test of worsening conditions? Lisa, okay, is this right? Am I helping these people? The test of murder? Just kidding. I don't really have to. Come on! Actually, I do have to watch that. I did that in the service once and somebody said, well, I don't have to deal with it. That actually happened. So, I was just joking around and said, come on. And so I fell on the ground and said, oh my God. That's terrible. The last thing I was expecting. Remember that? Said, if we talk about the test of responsibility, all right, we actually have, but we didn't do it in this last flow. We talked about responsibility quite a bit. We'll just hit on it like I've been doing with these right here. Let me just read some of my notes here. Testing of the foundation comes first before weight can be put on. Amen? In other words, God's not really, here's the deal. Most churches and most people are working on the externals and the exterior, trying to look better. All right? I'm always reminded in the Old Testament when Nehemiah or one of those guys started making reforms in Israel, the first thing it says they did was they went into the temple and pulled all the idols out. The last thing they did was repaint and fix up the outside of the temple. Now that's just the opposite of the enemy. He works from the outside in. God works from the inside out. Amen? And so God's first concern is not how good you look to everybody else, and most of you have found that out living around here. He's not trying to, you know, and you go, why won't you give me something here, Lord? You know what I mean? Well, help me to look better. And he keeps putting you in circumstances that may make you look worse. All right? Why is he doing that? Because he has no desire to be working on the walls or the roofs or anything until he gets a foundation laid. All right? And then once he's got that, he can start decorating it up a little bit. Praise the Lord. The problem is most people have Christmas tree righteousness instead of apple tree righteousness. Meaning they just put stuff on and it looks real glittery and flashes and all this kind of stuff, but it's not life. The tree is dead. Yeah. It has no fruit. It will never bear fruit. But an apple tree, you cannot put it on when you want to. It comes when it is the right time. So all attempts to produce something that is not an outflow of life and in working and roots will probably be tinsel and fleshy lights and things like that. And it looks good, but it's not Christ. And if you do it long enough, you'll become a Pharisee. So the goal would be that you wait patiently and that you work toward Christ in all things. So, laying a foundation is one of the harder things. If you know anything about buildings and everything, it's also one of the more expensive things. We ended up in Arkansas, they ended up getting the building done. We were putting in insulation, things like that, and we're talking about the price for everything. He told me the overall price, and the largest amount went to the foundation. So, God's efforts are going to be to lay something in you. Usually the foundation, isn't it interesting? Usually the foundation isn't really seen. You know, the thing that holds the whole thing together, and it's more or less buried or whatever, just like the roots. You don't see the roots. It's not only holding it up, giving it strength, it's feeding it. And it's the source for all life. So, in Christianity, we get after the Lord, we want to start showing signs right away. And that's fine. I appreciate less cussing from cigarette smoke. No question about it. But that's not near as important to me as that you put on the Lord Jesus Christ. So responsibility. Testament foundation comes first before weight can be put upon it. And so there will be this pressure that comes from time to time in your life. And you will not understand it. And you will say, it's the devil. Why is all this pressure on me? And it's not the devil. It's not the luck of the draw or the luck of the Irish. It is very simply God, your Father, testing, preparing for a greater measure in the future. And so, but see, we don't think like this. We've been taught to think it's either the devil or just bad times. Acts 5. And that's not the case. Let me just put this way. There's an actual Father at work in your life. And He loves you very much. I was thinking of that scripture the other day, and the Spirit of God hit me to turn the eyes with it. It says that He can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And the Spirit of God said that He put that down in the Bible so that you would know that He thinks about you. I really believe God has a very sensitive heart toward us. I believe that we don't think He loves us that much because we have expectations of what we say. If you do this, you love me. And He says, no, that's not how it works. It's on my basis. So, responsibility is an essential part of leadership training. You never know how secure your foundation is until weight has been put on it. But what is that weight? Part of that weight is the weight of responsibility. And here's the deal. It is real easy to be a little lamb in a flock. It's like George back then. Everybody loves George. Everybody wants to, you know, hold George at some time or another. Everybody likes to welcome him. Everybody likes to. Not every moment. But, you know, I mean, passing around, da 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 da, and all this kind of stuff, and like a little lamb in a flock, you can run and jump and chase butterflies, and other sheep will help pull you in, and all this kind of stuff, and everybody's watching out for the little lamb, and all this kind of stuff. It's, you know, it's just great. I mean, you have no real responsibility but to just kind of frolic. Oh, for the days of frolic. By the way, I'm going to tell you something. I'm looking in the mirror today. You see all that? My hair is actually brown. On both sides. I'm actually brown-headed still. All of it is coming straight out from here. It started back here like a yarmulke. I just worked its way through. I'm not as old as I appear. I certainly don't have as much wisdom as I appear to have. All right. But there's nothing like taking somebody who is used to having freedom and used to having a little responsibility, stick them in a place of responsibility, even if it be for a period of time. It's like, boy, things happen, man. And it really does. I'm telling you, that's one of the benefits of marriage. It'll work stuff in you that you wouldn't have worked in yourself. That's the truth. It'll do stuff in you that you would not have done. And I just had a thought about it. I takes it out of you. It's like, I don't know if the Lord.
The testing of murder.
I've often said, I never, ever, ever, you know, considered divorce in our marriage. Murder, yes, but not divorce. That's a joke. I have considered divorce. I'm just joking. I have not. I'm joking. When you're put in these situations, especially if, and here's the problem in those most local churches is, you come into their church, and if you show any signs like you're going to be there and be with them, they want to evaluate you and find out what your skills are and put you in your skilled position. We do not operate that way. We like putting you in positions that you have no clue how. And that's the truth. We enjoy doing this. And the reason is because we all have gone through that. But the real reason is because if you have talent and ability in something, you're going to lean to your own skills and ability and everything. If you don't, then you're going to have to call upon the Lord and maybe find the Lord in a whole new way you never even considered. And then what we end up is with somebody in a position that it's the Lord coming out of them because they have no other choice. Instead of people shining. Yeah. You know, you're not doing that at all. You're going, that's the Lord. And they're going, you better believe it is. Amen? I mean, you know, and you know that it is. And there's no pride or anything. You know, it's not like, I'm doing a good job. You're going, by the grace of God, this thing is still afloat because you put me in charge of it. And it's a blessing. It's a blessing. It's not a curse. And it's not, I mean, it is a scary thing. And it's particularly scary if you haven't been put into these situations too often yet, because you just the thought of going into it, you start thinking, I know I'm going to fail. And then the thoughts come, well, I'm going to look like an idiot in front of the whole body. Trust me, you already do. But, you know, if anybody can discern from the last class, we already know what you're talking about. And we love you anyway, okay? We still love you. It's okay. But that responsibility does put pressure. It puts pressure. And that pressure will prove you. It will help to prove you. Will help to see where your hands will go. Will you reach out on your own? Will you reach to the Lord? I mean, I love it when, you know, the disciples come up to Jesus, and I just love the whole story. I just love the Bible. I mean, this story is just a picture of the Bible. It's just, Jesus is with them, and he's going along. It says, and Jesus led him into a wilderness place. And then later on, they come to Jesus after he'd been teaching for hours and starting to get dark, sun's going down, and he says, we're in a wilderness place. And there is no food, and we've got, you know, thousands of people. What are we going to do? We can't send them away now. They'll never make it. It's a wilderness place. Now, some of you here would have said, well, we're here because Jesus led us here. If he was thinking ahead, we wouldn't be here now and in this pickle. And that's the way we think. The proof of true leadership of God is you lead always into green pastures. And that's not the truth at all. The Lord is my shepherd. He leads into the valley of the shadow. Trust me. Some of us here, if we had been with that group, we would have been putting Jesus down, thinking he didn't think ahead, he didn't have insight, you know, well, I need to go find me another man, the thought. And if course, if you got that much wisdom and insight and everything, why don't you live? But no, I got to go find another man so that if he doesn't meet my standard, I can rip him down. No, Jesus led them into the wilderness, wisely so. I love my Jesus. I love his wisdom. I love that he cares more than for my wants and desires. He cares for my soul. And so he comes and says, we got no food. And Jesus says, you give him food. I mean, they came to Jesus and said, look, we got this problem. And Jesus' response was, you give me. You know what the next word said? This he said to test them. Oh, Jesus is in the testing business. Yes, he is. This he said to test them. Whoa, I mean, can you imagine? Okay. The picture I always give, and this will be a good picture for you if you particularly if you work by pictures, but just the concept is great. The Lord showed me years and years ago when I was doing a lot of counseling with people and stuff. When people come into counseling, basically the reason why they come to you is they have a monkey on their back. It's almost like a very real monkey. It's not a little monkey, it's a big monkey to them. And their goal in coming into counseling usually is to somehow shift that monkey off of their back onto your back. Once it's on your back, they feel better, and you fix my problem. Okay? But the Lord taught me how to let them shift it over on me, and then for me to work it back around onto their back before it was over. Isn't that terrible? The goal being, if I solve everything for you, you'll be so weak you'll never be able to handle. Amen? However, it's not the session is not just a monkey shifting session. There are things that take place and transpire. Information given on how to deal with monkeys on your back. What to feed them. How to get ticks off of them. So This theme of responsibility is like a weight that is upon us, that when Jesus said, you give them to eat, this was going to be he was going to look around. Where would his source be? Well, there is no lack where Jesus is. The true Jesus. The true Jesus. Now, if we don't have the true Jesus, in 30 years of ministry, I faced an awful lot of stuff. Trust me, in 30 years, God will see to it, we face a lot of stuff. And, I've told you before about, we all believe in the God of miracles, and then when we have a crisis, we freak out. Where's our faith in the God of miracles? It's only a church thing. The joy over the God of miracles is a church service thing. But it should be a life thing, how we handle it. When it's an impossible situation that calls for a miracle, that's when we go, and I've done that with people before. Mike's been around, I think, when I did it before, way back, when people sat down with me and said, my God, we're in a tremendous crisis, a financial crisis that's going to bring the whole thing down. I mean, there's just no way and there's no hope and I can't imagine, there's just nothing to do. And I said, oh, goody, I guess we're going to have to trust in the God of miracles. And they kind of went, this ain't funny. And I went, this ain't a joke. I said, it meant to be funny. Walk by faith. Faith experiences, crisis faith, not faith. You do that by these things that happen and these conditions where it's beyond you, this responsibility that you can't carry. And you, he puts that, here's a good example. Jesus put the monkey on Philip's back. Philip handed it back to Jesus, not in the sense of getting rid of his load, but in the sense of coming to the source, the fountain. And Jesus said, well, what do you got? Well, I got five little doofus. Good. Okay, here I go. Pass it out. What do we got left? 12 baskets full. That's more than what the need was. More than the need. And I'm sorry that most of us always think in terms of the need. But Jesus is more than the need. And if we would see Jesus instead of the need, and if we would come to him for as our abundance, we would find that there is more. Now, let me say this. We're talking about this too. But if you get in a situation where your car breaks down or something, and most of you know that only recently that I've had a car. My car broke down for a good while. You're in that situation, nobody likes broken down cars. Is there anybody here you really like when your car breaks down? I think that's probably a bugaboo. Texas slang. You know, nobody likes a broken down car. So what do you do? What am I going to do? What am I going to do? And he said, well, we have a broken down car. You know, now we're only a one car family. It wasn't all that long ago that a one car family was doing pretty good. Most families were one car families. Now there are however many people you got in your family, that's how many cars you got. Amen? Everybody got to have a car. Well, you know, it used to be that, oh, honey, well, I'll drive you, and we'll just have to make do, and we'll work together, da-da-da-da, we'll just da-da-da-da. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Actually, something's kind of working there. It's kind of good. It's like, well, we love each other, we're a family. Nowadays, it's, I got my job, you got your job, I got my schedule, you got your schedule, I got my car, you got your car, I got my music in my car, you got your music in your car. And, oh, my God, I don't even want to ride in your car. Let's hear your music. You know, it's just, there's something wrong. But God can actually start working something between people and releasing the Spirit of Christ. And more Jesus could actually come forth by breaking down your car, making you subsist on more. Can anybody see that could be a possibility? That you might have to choke down your pride, your flesh, and your this and this, and then go, you know what? You know, let's, you know. And then you end up being happy. So, all these situations, we view everything as negative and bad, and everything is meant to destroy me. And that's not the truth. God is working to form his son. And the Bible says all things work together for good, not just good things work together for good. All things. Bad things can be your friend. Where is that in the Word of God? Paul said in 2 Corinthians that this light affliction worketh for us. What's it working for? Us. A far more and exceeding eternal way of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but the things that are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. It's not working for you while you're looking here going, why didn't he fix this? If God really loved me, this wouldn't have happened. No, because he loves you, he lets that happen in the hopes that you're in tune with him and will flow and come out and flourish. Amen. You ever heard that the wilderness shall bloom? Yeah. It's a miracle. I know. If he ever gets it in you, you're in the middle of a wilderness and you start blooming. It's a miracle. Greater than what happened over in the land of Israel, it sees life coming forth when it ought to be choked out. Because you're living based on something higher. So, I'm just to try to finish reading this little part. Foundational people or leaders who continually throw off responsibility or carefully avoid it should be more closely examined in light of their position. And all I mean by that is that this is the fact, and I don't want to say this, but I'm going to say it. Actually, I don't want to say it. I used to want to say this, but I don't want to say it. If it's from the Lord, I don't mind saying anything from the Lord. I have no nothing behind it other than what the Lord wants to say. People are constantly weighing. They have this, what's this thing called, scale now? Balance of scales. They're constantly weighing everything. They have, it's an inward thing. It's just like on the inside of them. They walk around like this. Over here is intake. You know? And they're weighing how much. And they have a line drawn on the wall. Anybody growing up, your parents used to mark a line. And you come back 2 years later, a year later, they mark it. Well, they have a fixed line of how much they can handle. This is how much I can handle. This is how much I can handle. Oh, I know how much I can handle. Don't put any more on this side than I can handle, or you will see me. And not just put in your face, but you know why I know about this? Because I watch. No. The truth is, I know about this because I was once there. And I don't know, man. I don't know what my deal was. I don't know if it was my drug past or whatever, you know, a certain amount of paranoia, a certain amount of, I can't handle it, man. I'm going to blow. I don't know what it was. But, you know, there's just this thought, this thing, this inworking that was Randy. It wasn't the Lord. That I can't take much more than this. You know, we say, God will not put any more on us than we can bear. How many of you have known God to do more than what you can bear, at least according to your understanding of that scripture? Most of us. All right. So he must mean something different. All right. Because we have a measure. And that measure is, I can only handle this much, and if you give, and it's like this. Okay. If you put one thing more than I can handle here, I take one off over here. Anybody catch that? You put, okay, put them on, that's fine, fine, all. You put that one extra that puts it over, I take one off here. I keep it balanced. I can only handle 10 things. You put five here and five here, you just put six here, I have to take one off here, and six and four are still 10. Does that help a little bit? Not in the map. Not in the pictures or map. Okay, what else is there? Let's see. Okay. Kid laughing. Ooh, yeah.
Yes, Lord.
I knew I'd hit home with something like that. It is just this reality that we are protecting ourselves, and to a certain degree, rightly so. I mean, my God, I don't want anybody going insane on me. So I'm not calling for, immediately following this class, we will dump 10 extra things on your 10 already. Nothing like that. We're just talking about spiritual reality and growth and being a good leader. And trust me, whatever you can handle now, be able to have a whole lot more. But you will particularly be able to do that if you begin to develop this mindset. And this is a true thing I'm about to tell you. J.W. said one of these true things up there, and I came up and I said, brother, if nobody else here believes you, I believe you, because I have a few true things that I say that nobody believes me on. This is a true thing. I personally, I'm one of the weakest men that I know. Again, I'm one of the weakest men that I know. I truly am. I am frail. I am fragile. And I don't know what, those words are very good descriptions of me. With that, well, I might as well say this, I've never said this before. supposedly, you know, when my father left my mother when I was 3 years old, he kind of flipped out and crazy. Nobody, not my mom, not us, nor his brothers and sisters, nor anybody else on the planet ever saw the man again until I found him at 40-some. That's pretty fragile. My mom freaked out at a certain juncture and was put in the same side for a while. I feel things sometimes on the inside of me. But at the same moment, I have found Jesus so much more than Randy Munsonberg. So much beyond my frailties. And this isn't just work. This is just, it is intimate fact to me. And so in my early days, I was very cognizant of the weight ratio that worked in my life, lest, you know, whatever. I mean, I didn't even want to think in that direction. But I saw, number one, God kept putting me in the situations. Number two, I saw that if I'm going to be worth anything to God, I'm going to have to get beyond this. Mine was like this. Yours may be, you know, you may have a wider swing. Mine was like, ah! No! It wasn't much. It really wasn't. And I thought, man, I'm not going to be worth anything to anybody. I mean, my God, I fully intend to live my life for God. I've got to get a wider swing. I've got to get more ability to carry than whatever. I realized that that wasn't anything about me getting more ability to carry or a wider swing. I realized that that was plugging in to the vine and all the root and fatness that was his. I'm still the weak person that I've always been. The difference is, and I know that some people doubt my words or can't comprehend them because they see strength and firmness and better than a lot of things in me that they don't. Oh, I admire that. He's such a whatever. Such a Texan. It's nothing. It's Christ. It's Jesus Christ. Not my Lord, but my life. And just to pray and say, Lord, I'm tired of constantly shifting from 4 and 6 to 5 and 5 to 2 and 8 to 1 and 9 to, understand what I mean, always working to keep it because I know what I can handle and you don't. But to just get to a place in the Lord where you say, Lord, I want to quit relying on me. I want to quit weighing and measuring by me, by my first birth. And start living by the new birth. All right. Now, this little disclaimer. I'm not putting that on anybody. I'm just telling you that's a good idea. You may not be able to handle more than you may not even like what I'm saying and want. I'm telling you what's better, not just for you, but for the kingdom of God, others, God. But if you want to, you will get in situations where you will feel that pressure. And at that moment, just try saying, Lord, I'm a branch and you are the vine. And for once, I'd like to find out if that really works or is just going to remain a doctrine with me. Would that be cool? And if it doesn't work, then throw it out and say, that Randy, that idiot who put me in this situation. Never trust him. That's fine. But I believe that God is speaking here tonight. I really believe that. I believe God is speaking. And I don't believe he's rebuking anybody. I believe that there is a whole new level that God wants to bring you to, and you will be more happy than you could ever imagine. I I don't feel the stuff as strong as I used to. Now, when God does everything and strips everything away, you feel it pretty acute. But even in that time, when it seems like everything, maybe one thread is left, I still have held on to the Lord and made it because of Christ my life, not because of Christ my helper and the source of the vine. Anyway, enough said on that, and you know, take it as the Spirit of God leads you. All right, the test of the hirelings. Anybody know what a hireling is? Got a couple of scriptures. Turn with me to, I guess tonight's the night we're going to be with Matthew. Matthew 20. By the way, this is an excellent book. You did well. I refer to you often. Hallelujah. There's a whole lot here. There's so much here. I've got several scriptures. This one is dealing with the parable of the laborers and hiring people to do the job. I tell you what, if you want to just mark Matthew 20, verse 1 through, really all the way down to 16, where the first should be last and last should be first. The basic premise is this, that he hired some guys to come, went out early in the morning and said, hey, does anybody need a job? He said, oh. You know? So he said, okay, here's the deal. Work for me all day and I'll give you this amount. Okay? He said, okay. So they went, they're working, they're working, they're working, they're finding the heat of the day, they're working through the heat of the day. And as evening comes, the master goes out and finds some other laborers and says, hey, anybody need some work? He says, oh. I said, okay, come work in my fields. And he said, I'll give you so-and-so. And it was the same amount he was going to give the other guys who worked all day. And when they heard it, they went, well, this ain't right. You're giving them the same thing you gave us. We've been working in the heat of the day. He said, we agreed on what you'd get. And everything. Why are you griping about that? Nothing's changed on your part. They were hirelings. Okay. Not fully the best example. That's why I have some other scriptures here. Jeremiah 46. By the way, we're talking about leaders who are hirelings instead of, in case you're not following this. Jeremiah 46, 21. And I guess we go to 20. Egypt is like a very fair heifer, but destruction cometh out of the north. And the hired, and also her hired men are in the midst of her like fatted bullocks, for they are also turned back and are fled away together. They did not stand because the day of their calamity was come upon them at the time of their judgment. And so we have those who are the hired men who are in the midst, who are like fatted bullocks. They are paid, in the sense that it doesn't have to be money now, but they are rewarded on some level, whether it be with prestige or title or whatever, and they are, they think that they're a strong leader because they're carrying on until the day of their calamity comes. And when that day comes, they don't stand. They can't stand because they're hirelings. The pay is not good enough. Okay? But somebody who's not a hireling, you stand if it means your life. You stand. Remember David's mighty men? Remember the guy that stood in the field with the sword, killed what, several hundred Philistines, and it stood so long that the sword just melted into his hand? Well, you know, that's somebody who's become one with the Lord. The two have become one. You're not just, you know, standing there, you're separate from the Lord, separate from this thing. Way, other people are running, and apparently in that case, everybody left the field with him. And he said, I'm standing in where? I'm not going to take this field. Hard-headed Jews. Nothing worse than hard-headed Jews in Texas, but anyway. and just said, I will not give this up. And you see the oneness that has come within him. his arm and your sword all as it were one. And there is no difference now. He is not thinking of self, he is thinking, this is God's field. And it's, you know, it's not going down, you're going. You know, too many think of themselves and go, well, you know, I mean, see, that's the thing. Oh, I've got some stuff I can share. I'm not kidding because it's just so good. Lord, freshly shared it with me about, no, I'm not kidding. Oh, it's good. It's good. It's good. It's about this very thing. And difference it makes when you have become one as opposed to serving Jesus. When you're one with Jesus as opposed to serving Jesus. Because all Christians serve Jesus, but not all function as one. All right, since we're in the neighborhood, Ezekiel 34. And this is good also to loosen up those pages in Ezekiel if you haven't read it. Ezekiel 34. Let's start with verse 1. And the word of the Lord come unto me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say unto them, Thus saith the Lord God of the shepherds, Woe be to the shepherds of Israel, that they feed themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flock? Ye eat the fat, and ye clothe yourself with the wool. Ye kill those that are fed, but ye feed not the flock. And of course, this is talking about a hireling. This is somebody who does what they do for personal gain. That's why you do it. It's a thing of motivation. You understand what I'm doing? It's a thing of motivation. It's not something that, it's something inward that you do. And, you know, you care for the flock and you care, you feed the sheep. Because Jesus said, do you love me? Yes, I love you. Feed the sheep. Okay, well, I'm tired now. But you couldn't love me? No, I'm tired. Anybody catch what I'm saying here? Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Okay, I'll feed my sheep. I'll feed your sheep. But you quit. And then he says, did you quit loving me? No, I just got tired. Do you love me? Yeah, feed my sheep. I will, but I'm tired. It's about you and not about him. But I'm telling you, when your love becomes a, you know, love is a knitting thing. Did you know that? Knowledge doesn't necessarily knit you, it puffs you up. Love can knit you in. Knit you with that person. Most people that are in love end up staying together for weeks. It's an amazing thing. It's the power of love. But it's you know, true God-given agape love will knit you in with him. Just like those mighty men you're talking about, you know what? The bottom line of those mighty men was they loved it. And that's the truth. They love it. At the risk of their own life, they were not hiring. They love. And so, you have this situation where it's, well, what I can get out of this, and what da 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 da, and all this kind of stuff. When that which is the Lord's is out from the Lord. How do I word this? There's so many scriptures coming to my mind. Jesus said to Peter, if I don't wash your feet also, you have no part in me. The whole deal is, he's not saying, it's so bad how we read the scripture. Well, you say, I don't want any part in you. No, 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 no. He is saying, I don't want to just wash you. I don't want us to just do things together. I want you to be part of me. Mary, you've chosen the greater part. You're partaking of me. Can you not see that? We're just talking about the heart of the Lord again. Having a part in him, having oneness, having a knit relationship, being knit together in one. And so you bear burdens that you wouldn't normally bear. You do. But the deal is you don't just bear burdens that you wouldn't normally bear. There's consistency because you're not a hireling. You do it because you love the Lord. You do it because you love others. You may not love a person in the sense of that. You love what God loves. You love what God loves. You love his body. You love his family. Where thou goest, I will go. Your people are my people. That's your people. They're my people. Somebody, Jerry, says, but I don't like those people. They're his people. I love him. They're my people. See, I mean, something happens in you. Right? What do you, you know, you don't teach this into somebody. You don't Bible school somebody into this. You know, this is either in you or it's not in you. If it's not in you, then you need to go find a good paying job. No, I mean, that's what a hiring is. I guess let's just go to John 15. Anybody think of John 15? Is it John 15 or is it John 10?
John 10.
I'm sorry. Maybe you can help me because I was just thinking of it and here it is, verse 12. Let's start up at verse 11. I am the good shepherd. Oh, now there it is right there. There it is. That's enough. That's enough. I mean, if you didn't read anything else, you want to be a good shepherd? You'll never be a good shepherd. But you can have the good shepherd. You can have the I am. And he'll make you an excellent shepherd, but you won't be you. And you'll never boast in glory in him. You'll just go, hey, it's the Lord. Somebody says, oh, you're so kind and gentle to us little lambs. You go, trust me, see what? You know, they go, oh, and he's humble too. You go, no, it's the Lord. It's really the Lord. Oh, God, he just keeps pursuing humility. It's the Lord, idiot! Because you become adamant that Christ get the glory, not that you appear as humble. Why? Because he is Christ. And to do anything else would be a highlight ripping off his glory. But let's read on. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Who is going to give his life for the sheep in this group? Who among you will rise and give your life for the sheep? None of you. He is the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. All right? But you can have the good shepherd in you, dwelling in you, and you can have a relationship with him whereby he flows out of you, and you give your life. When the, you know, David said, when the bear came, I turned tail and ran. Brave, 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 so run. No. When the lion came, I took him by the beard and I slew him. Yeah. That Christ could be formed in us. Can Christ be formed in you? Is there any hope for you? Yes, Christ in you is the hope. Therefore, you have much hope. You have no walls. You have no limitations. I don't care what your past is. I don't care what your failures are. I don't care how messed up you are. At this moment, if you can embrace that Christ can be all things in you, then the limitations are just, they're, it's without walls. The limitations are without limitations. Christ is enough and over. That's what superabundant grace is. It's more than enough to get the end. It just lavishes you with the extra. Alright, so we haven't got to the scripture yet. Verse 12, but he that is an hireling and not the shepherd. Isn't that great? He said, I am the good shepherd. Good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But he that's a hireling, anything that is not the good shepherd is what? Hireling. Why? He that is a hireling is not the shepherd. What's the problem here? He that is a hireling is a weaker. No. He that is a hireling is a coward. No. He that is a hireling is a money grubber. No. He that is a hireling is not the shepherd. Jesus is the shepherd. And Jesus in you will shepherd without wages. Amen? But he that is a hireling is not the shepherd. We could just face that. It's real easy. You look and you examine and you go, you know what? trouble starts happening, first thing I want to do is run. And then you say, that's not the shepherd. So the answer is real simple here. Lord, form the good shepherd in me. Don't just change me, exchange me. Don't just make me better, more shepherd-like. Throw me out and form the shepherd in me. Let the I am inhabit this temple. He says, but he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming, and leaveth the sheep, and fleeth, and the wolf catcheth them, and scattereth the sheep. So he's in there. He sees a wolf coming. He goes, oh my God, there's a wolf. This is bad. This isn't like yesterday when it was sunny and pretty and wonderful. And I ate on the hill, and somebody took a picture of the pastoral scene, and the sheep down there, and me on the hill, leaning back with a skill of grass on my mouth, and a staff like this. Birds singing, butterflies buttering. No, my God, there's a wolf, and he's got red eyes, and he's showing his fangs, and he's coming straight at me, and my God, I gotta get out of here, this is not good. That's you. You will do that. You will, what we call, freak out. You will freak out. Okay? But all of the shepherds form me. I have a picture somebody gave me. I don't display it very often anymore, but it used to be in my office. I have an office, that's why I don't display it. There's nothing here. One time when I was a very famous pastor, I had an office with a picture. And in that picture, it really is a great picture. There's a picture of two wolves over here, and one's on a hill, eye level to the shepherd, and he's standing there, and he's got a staff. And you don't actually see the shepherd's face, you see it kind of angled toward that wolf, but you see the wolf's face. And he is looking into the eyes of that shepherd, and it looks kind of like, know about this. I mean, you can see that that wolf's kind of like, I think we picked the wrong flock. I love that picture. I love that picture. I love the red eyes of the wolf and the teeth on us. Saliva going down and the hair falls back. And I love the eyes of the shepherd that come out of you when you look at that. You say, you may tangle into me and you may rip into me. May open wounds and do all sorts of stuff. But in the name of Jesus, you will not get to this flock. I'll take every scar and every bite. I love that Jesus. Anybody love that Jesus? It's called the Good Shepherd. Called the Good Shepherd. He's awesome. He's awesome. He's truly, truly awesome. Anyway, there's a little more here. The hireling fleeth because he's a hireling. Why is he fleeing? Because he's a hireling. Why did he flee in the verse before? Because he's not the shepherd. Okay, two reasons he flees. He's not the shepherd because he's a hireling. Okay? And careth not for the sheep. What does he care for? Right. It's not that he cares for the money. Right? He cares for himself. But do not miss the point of this. A hireling is not a person that is doing it for the money. A hireling does it for himself. It may be money, it may be any number of things, but the real motivation is he cares for himself and not the sheep. So, chips are down, he's looking for a way out. He's looking for an exit somewhere, Okay. He fleeth because he doesn't care. He doesn't care. He does care, but he doesn't care. He cares for himself, but he doesn't care for someone else. I care for you when it doesn't infringe upon me. Anybody getting this? Oh, I care deeply for you when it doesn't infringe on me. But if I'm going to have to take a whooping for you, well, I don't deserve it. And besides, if I end up getting whooped, and this goes in the newspaper, the local pastor gets whooped. I mean, my reputation will be down the tubes. I'm supposed to be a winner. You know? I'm out of here. He doesn't care. He cares deeply for himself, his reputation, his own peace of mind, his own comfort, his own, you know, he weighs this ravenous predator in light of his own strength, and he says, no, I can't do it. I mean, this, the end of this could be bad for me. Whereas the good shepherd weighs the situation in light of others and says, at whatever cost to me, I will protect that which is the Lord's. At whatever cost, including death, I would rather die standing against something for the glory of God, then live as a captive. You're not going to have that in you unless it's in you. And that's only in you by the good shepherd. He's the only one that is truly and fully that way. So, in closing, where does it leave us? Where does it leave us? Needing Jesus. It leaves us going away from here going, Lord, I need you. I want you. I want you formed in you. I don't just want to be a pastor or shepherd or leader or do something great for you. I want the good shepherd, your son, formed in me. Because I will fail in the crunch if he is not. And we will. We will. And I guess this is my second closing, but he will need to allow you to fail before you see how deep you need him. And it is not easy. It's not an easy road. It is the path of glory. But it's not glorious. It's the path where you are stripped. You're found to be what you are. You're found wanting. Handwriting's on the wall. You're found wanting. And you live going, oh my God, it's not my name. And the voice comes and says, everything's going to be taken away. But we're more than Babylonians. When we see it written there, we come to a place where you go, oh, that's old news. No, really. I got that one down. I am found wanting. Now, if you're reminding me of that, I'm with you. If you're bringing it up because I need to re-plug back into the source, I'm with you. You know, understand what I'm saying? I mean, there's something that settles in you that Christ is all and in all. Christ is the fullness. He is the length and the breadth and the height and the depth. And Jesus is not just a religion and a religious figure and a guy with a robe and a beard somewhere. He is my very own life. And as such, how sweet the Lord is. Moment by moment, day by day, situation by situation, to whom goes all glory. And it's not words and beautiful phraseology. It is the worship of your heart for this Jesus. Father, thank you for your word, not my word, not my sharing. God, thank you for your word, because I know that you're speaking to your sheep and your people tonight. Maybe even things that I'm not addressing, that's your business. Bless what you are saying to them. Minister to each person, Lord. Help us to recognize We don't need things. We need the fountain of living waters. Father, help us to see that you have sent Jesus Christ as the answer to all. And until we have come to him and embraced him, and yet embrace him moment by moment, then we are but humans like little chicks running around trying to find our own way. Just feel it while your heads are bowed. Maybe we ought to pray a little prayer. Some of you may have been dealt with specifically and you'd like a little prayer. I don't know if, you know, we've got a lot of people in the room. There may be somebody here that you've never really asked Jesus as your Savior and life and Lord and fullness. And this is your time and Jesus is here and he cares about you. It's not joining a religion, it is being filled with him that is all. All hopelessness begins to go away because Christ is the answer, not to you, but in you. Since we're all have our head bowed, is there anybody who just would like some prayer on this level for Jesus? Just lift your hand up. Yes, I see your hand. You put it down. Anybody else? Yes, I see your hand. Anybody else? Yes, I see your hand. Anybody else? Yes. Tonight may be your night. Yes, I see you. Yes, I see you. Anybody else? 5 or 6? Yes, I see you. 7, 8? Yes, I see you. 9? And to anybody else, don't be shy. This is important. This is coming. I see your hand. Yes, anybody else? It's important. I'm not going to make a big deal out of it. Anybody that you just don't know. I mean, God has been speaking to you, and you don't know the words, the need, or the stirring in you can be verbalized by a man giving an altar call. You just feel like moving toward God. Would you slip your hand? Yes, I see your hands all over the place. Anybody else? Amen. Okay. We're just going to pray. Just keep your head bowed. Father, I thank you for the hunger, concern, and care of your people. I thank you that they reach out to you. And I sense in this place, Lord, the longing soul. You said that you would satisfy the longing soul. I sense a real, genuine longing in some here tonight. That it is almost a verballess longing. And so, Lord, you satisfy the longing soul. You satisfy the longing heart. You alone. And so I ask you for every hand that was raised, Lord, if there be other hearts that are feel moved toward you on some level, we didn't mention it in our altar call, that you meet them right where they're at, right where you have drawn them to. I believe that you have drawn many out tonight unto you, and they have responded to you. They love you. They see their need of you. They ache because of their failures of your life and nature. And yet, they press on. They know they cannot fulfill it in themselves. They know that they are inadequate, and that is a grief to them. But on the other hand, they will not cease. You are the one that has the words of eternal life. And so, Lord, strengthen them. Pursue to press in and call upon the name of your Son. Loose the Holy Spirit. Some of you, I just sense somebody needs to be stirred up in the Holy Spirit. Who is that? Who Would you raise your hand? Third, fourth hand, five, six. Okay, anybody else? You need to be stirred up in this. I think we need to do this publicly because we need to lay hands. You know, the scriptures say that. It says that. It says the stirring up of the Holy Spirit through the laying on of hands. So I'm going to ask you to just come on up here. Let's do it, man. Let's just do it. Man, let's just get the Spirit of God stirred up. Let's allow the Holy Spirit to have His word. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to just stir Him up. Move by your Spirit. The flames and the ember, stir up in the name of Jesus. Yes, hallelujah. Stir up in the name of Jesus. Stir in Jesus' name. Stir, Holy Spirit, that inhabits them. Oh, the end of my people. Stir in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. There it is. Come on, move it up. That's the Lord. That's the Lord. That's the Lord. Yes, the Spirit of God wants to really move on you right now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. There he comes. Come on. That's like, well enough. That's him. He's filling me up. It's coming from here and heading toward the top here. Hallelujah. Stir up, Lord. Stir up in Jesus' name. Stir him up, Lord. Stir him up in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Right there. Yes, that's it. That's the Lord. That's the Spirit of God. Revitalize. Hallelujah. That's good. That's good. That's good. The Lord's pleased with that. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Jesus' name. Stir and move by your Spirit. Stir and move. Hallelujah. Stir and move by your Spirit. Stir and move by your Spirit. Hallelujah. Stir and move by your Spirit. Can you help me come down in the name of Jesus? Hallelujah. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. George, you ready to receive the Holy Spirit? In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. The Spirit of God is upon you right now. He is upon you not just to make you feel better, but He is upon you to do what you have heard with this. With your spiritual ears. He that has had an ear to hear tonight, the Spirit of God has come in a fresh way. Release your faith. Rejoice that the Spirit of God desires to bring forth this and that your movement toward Him is for His purposes. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Amen. Why don't the rest of you just be seated for a minute? I have one more thing, and it's a weird deal, so I have to make sure nobody's standing for it. And I do want you to sit, and please, if you would, bow your head and close your eyes just for a second. This, you know, the Lord is moves in different ways and things like that, and so would you bow your head and close your eyes just for a second? The Lord is saying to me that somebody has failed in relationship to a sexual sin, and that the Lord is not all concerned over the sexual sin like you would think. He is concerned over the fact that it's starting to harden you in relationship to an openness to Him, and that you're crying out for more and more openness and a breakthrough and that sort of thing. And it's like a wall. It's like a wall that is blocking a flow, and He really, really cares about you. And this is not a rebuke or a condemnation sort of thing or that sort of deal at all. It's just that He looks into your, and I'm going to word it the way it says, your precious heart, and He sees you behind a wall, and like a child, you're being smothered. You're being smothered. And He really does want to help you. And so the first step is you just need to say in your heart, I'm with you, Lord, and Lord, forgive me of any passing, whatever sin that you might commit, the blood of Jesus cleanses you from all unrighteousness. Do you believe that? The blood of Jesus cleanses you from all unrighteousness. But more important than that, the word of the Lord to you is, I love you and I want to free you from behind this wall and to break you from the blockage that you're sensing right now. Let me say that you think, oh, I'll fail again and therefore the wall will go back up. Let me tell you something. If God's speaking to you right now, you need to trust that. He may not speak tomorrow, the next day, or next week, or next month, but if He's speaking to you right now, you need to trust that He doesn't have a temporal thing in mind. Let me also say to you that you may worry on all sorts of fronts about all sorts of things in relationship to this, and I'm telling you, just let your heart be drawn out to the Lord. He loves you. He loves you. I love you. We love you. God loves you. This is the greatest sin of all, wouldn't it, to be not to respond to His advances of love towards you, to draw you to Him and to answer your prayers. And so this prayer has to do with two things. One is just get forgiveness for whatever's past. Let it all be covered and your slate be clean. Number two, let Him, by forgiving them, take down the wall long enough that He can speak or move or say or do something. And that may have nothing to do with fixing anything in the earth. It may have everything to do with reaching heart to heart and saving you from maybe the clutches of the enemy who would separate. I don't know. I'm afraid to say too much because you'll read into it something other than just purely the Lord building that bridge back across for your safety, for your protection, for your security. So, enough said. Every head bowed, please. Every eye closed, if you will. Is there anybody you feel? No, I'm not gonna call people up or anything. I just want to respond to the Lord. Anybody feel that includes you? Just slip your hand up real quick and then down again. That's good enough. Give just a second here. But if there be anybody else, this is the Lord. This has nothing to do. I don't care. Okay. I care about you. That's what I care about. Anybody else? You know, slip your hand up in relationship to this prayer. Okay. Anybody else? I see your hand. Anybody else? Okay. I see your hand. Anybody else? Let's quickly do this. I just want to make sure one thing. Do not say in your heart, well, I'm afraid Randy would know something of this or that or whatever. You need to look into my heart. I see Jesus. I don't see you. I'm for you. I don't care. I care about your soul. Just please respond to the Lord. Okay? All right. One more chance. Slip your hand up. If that includes you, so we can pray that this bridge build. Hallelujah. All right. There we go. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you by your precious blood to forgive and to wash away every sin that has been committed. In the name of Jesus, that every sin is washed away. Lord, a clean slate right now. Clean as if they never sinned. Justified. Just as if they never sinned. Now, Lord, you have done that. When we asked, you responded, you have forgiven, and you have forgotten. You didn't just forgive. If they try to bring this up to you, you will not know what they're talking about. You have forgiven and forgotten. So there needs to be another hand there before I continue on. Anybody else? One more hand? Yeah. So Lord, right now, we accept the finished work of the cross and the forgiveness provided through the precious blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that that is settled. Now, Lord, there's only one concern. There's only one concern, and that is that they not be walled in, but that there be this bridge of life and this outlet, this opening in the top of the ark, this breath of fresh air, this avenue for the heavens to touch the earth, for the link, for the Jacob's ladder to be there where the angels ascend and descend. Lord, that there be living contact. In the name of Jesus, Lord, for I just ask you to move upon each one, knowing that they stand before you without guilt and condemnation and are forgiven. Thank you for that. Now, Lord, open the door and the bridge and let there be a glorious flow and a renewal of coming together, this one with you, Lord. Father, thank you right now. I release my faith and I release your spirit to accomplish this in my life. Thank you, Lord, for those that were willing, Lord. Without fear, they want you so bad, they just stepped out there. Thank you for that, Lord. Lord, instead of thinking anything bad, I am so proud and consider precious those that against all odds, like the harlot that pressed into the Pharisee's house, knowing he would look at her with condemnation, warning Jesus at the cost of anything like that. Bless him, Lord. Bless him beyond what you intended to bless him when you started this prayer. Now, Father, we just thank you for your goodness tonight. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives. We embrace you. We love you. We ask you to fill us with all the fullness which is Christ. Let the great I Am dwell in us. In Jesus' name. Amen.